Multitouch can seem intimidating, but not only is it easier than you might think, it's also pretty instructive. Hello everyone, my name is Sam Spade, and in this short series, I'm going to go over how to handle multiple touches. In this first tutorial, I'm going to cover the basics of what multi-touch is and what makes multi-touch unique. And in the next tutorials, I'll be covering a couple different ways of actually implementing them in your games. Let's start by talking about how user input works in general. You have your game, and your game takes user input. The way I like to think about this is that internal to your game, all user input is actually monitored by the GM engine, which acts sort of as a go-between for the user input and your code. You essentially ask GameMaker, has there been any input? And you do this with an event or one of the built-in functions. And if there is, then you can use it. And I want to stress that this is just a mental model. Whether or not it is actually implemented this way, I don't know, but I think it is useful to think about it this way, or at least it has been for me. So the first way that we can get user input from GameMaker is by using the built-in events. There are keyboard events, mouse and global mouse events, and of course, gestures. And gesture events work for touches and global touches out of the box. I would use these whenever possible, but sometimes it just isn't. And it can be a little bit clunky for certain types of touches as well. Still, you should familiarize yourself with the built-in gesture events and use these whenever possible. Next, we have the built-in functions. You have keyboard check pressed and the various related functions for keyboard keys, mouse check for mouses if you are on a PC of some type, gamepad button check if you want to use a gamepad, and finally, device mouse check buttons and those associated functions. You can use these for mouse input, but most importantly for us, you can also use them to deal with multi-touch. So if we have these functions that let us handle multiple touches, what makes multi-touch so tricky? Well, when you're dealing with a mouse, you just have one mouse, but you can track the buttons, whether they are pressed, held, or released, and of course, the location of the mouse pointer. But every time you ask GameMaker if there's been any input, you don't have to specify anything except the type of input that you're looking for, because again, there's only one mouse. But with multi-touch, you don't just have one touch, you have multiple. This means you have to write your code to work, sometimes with a generic reference. You could be referencing any one of these touches, and sometimes with a specific reference. You need to reference this touch and only this touch. For example, let's say you have a button that you can press, hold, and then release. For pressing that button, you need to check for a touch from any one of your multiple touches. But once that button is pressed, you need to know which touch it was, and then track that specific touch so that when that touch is released, the button can be released. And it is this interplay between sometimes checking for any touch and sometimes needing to track specific touches that makes multi-touch a bit more challenging. But there are a couple of other key differences. The first is that you don't really care about the position of a touch unless the touch is occurring. Unlike with a mouse, where you might want to follow something around even if no button is being held, with touches, you generally don't do this for an obvious reason. We don't have any way of tracking a user's fingers if they aren't touching the screen. Next, you only have one button. There either is a touch or there isn't. Now, this isn't inherently true because you can set it up so that double touches are read as a right mouse button, and you can write multi-touch code that also works with a mouse. But in general, we're going to assume that a touch is a single button or a single touch. Finally, order of touch is very important. Touches are always assigned to the lowest available position, starting at zero. And this can be a bit tricky to explain without an example, so I've got a small project running here on my Android tablet. If there are no touches, and then there is one touch, that touch is touch zero, always. It doesn't matter where on the screen it is. You can see here that touch zero is essentially teleporting around the screen, and the screen obviously doesn't care which finger I'm using. However, if you keep the first touch down and then create another touch, that touch is now one. And of course, you can have touch 2, 3, and 4, or 5 touches total. Now, what is important to remember, though, is that the touch is always assigned to the lowest number possible. So if I release touch 0, and now touch somewhere else, that isn't touch 5, that is touch 0. Likewise, if I now release touch 2, and start touching somewhere else, those touches will be touch 2, because again, that's the lowest available number now. In summary, you can get user touch input either through gesture events or the built-in device mouse functions. If you are going to do it through the device mouse functions, which is what we will be doing in this series, then your code must be flexible enough to handle general touches while also being able to track specific touches. And finally, we want to keep in mind some of the ways that multi-touch is different. We generally only track touches when the touch is occurring, and we treat it as a single button, and we have to keep in mind how ordering of touches works. In the next tutorial, we'll get into actually coding some multi-touch functions, and it is going to use arrays and loops. So if you aren't already familiar with those ideas, check out these videos down below.